By now, you've gotten through chapter one, this question, what is art? Now we're gonna look at another window into a world of art. And this is what I call art in the first and second function. Now, that first and second function are not a typical term that we find in the world of philosophy and we find in the world of dance, although there's instances where they exist there. Now, some of you have heard the words first and second function. Some of you have gotten that at UNLV. It's a phenomenon and it's something that we encounter. So my question is, because I always like to ask these questions, is where did the terms first and second function come from and what do they mean? Now, some of you would say, I heard this in choreography class and we were dealing with works of art that were either representational, where they meant something, what we termed the second function, where they represented something else that a work that a painting isn't or a dance isn't, or they were abstract. And if they were highly abstract, we would say that they were first functional. Now, we're gonna take those terms apart, but I really wanna get back to the where and how it got to UNLV, because that's important. This is Eric Hawkins, who is a mentor of mine and one of the seminal choreographers of the 20th century. And Eric Hawkins happened upon these terms when a philosopher came to one of his performances, one of his first performances after he left Martha Graham, when he was creating works that were uniquely his. A philosopher came and said, "I understand your work because what you're doing is dealing with art in the first and second function." Now, this was a revelation, as we have the Liu Fan behind me, revelation number four. This was a revelation for Eric Hawkins. And this philosophy, he then delved into this philosopher, and it gave him courage and it gave him an armature of ideas with which to create many of the works that he then did in his lifetime and the important works of modern dance from this important choreographer, Eric Hawkins. Yeah. Now, in the world of art, let's look at a couple visual art pieces, because I could show you this work here by Morris Lewis, or I can show you this work here by Jackson Pollock. Now, these works challenged the art world, because when people made them, people looked at them and said, "How is this a work of art?" And they would even say things like, "It looks like a child made this. It looked like, what is it? What does it mean? And how can this splattered canvas be a painting and be an important painting?" And perhaps they were questioning, as Clive Bell brought up, the significant form of it, because it didn't, what did this represent? This is the big thing that we're gonna grapple with and we're gonna tackle when we deal with the first and second function. Now, a couple things as introduction to this lecture I wanna say is that you're gonna see that the emphasis of this lecture, I'm gonna be pushing for the first function, being able to see works of art in the first function. Because most of us are trained from very young ages to think about the second function meaning of a work of art, you know? And when you could probably remember in elementary school when they said who, what, where, when, why, these were the important questions, and how. These were the questions to ask about a story and about an object. How did it answer those questions, and how do you find those meanings in this work? I'm gonna push for the other side. That's all very second function, and we're gonna get to what that is when we take these apart. But just know that in my lecture, I'm pushing for the first function just because I want you to pay attention to it and I want you to learn how to look at the first function in the world of art and in the world, and then also to be able to see the second function in the world. The important thing is that we can, in our heads, and we use different parts of our brains to do this, we can see things both in first function and second function. Those two worlds come together as our experience of a work. And you'll notice I did that in our art encounter when I said, let's not worry about what this means. Let's just enjoy the colors and the choices the artist made, the materials that are in this work of art. Okay, so both first and function are important, and we find both in most pieces of art. Also, I want to point out that ultimately, there's just not an either or of first function and second function. Although the philosopher we're going to study really defined those two terms so separately, but you're going to find that artists actually use both. And what I think of is a sliding scale between first and second function. So that some works can be far more abstract and far more first functional than other works of art. And one of the things that's quite fun, once you get these terms, is to be able to compare works of art and say, oh, this one is far more second function, and this one moves far more towards the first function. We're gonna do that with dance works within this lecture as well. So the other thing about this lecture, it brings us to that divide. That idea of what things do we see universally and what things do we see and do we have to know about and do we see individually based on the knowledge that we can postulate about and think about. So that's another fascination for me. And then it's also fun in this lecture because once you get it, you can then sometimes understand abstraction and understand this, all of these works that sometimes confuse people in the world. So it's wonderful. Welcome to lecture number 2, Art in the First and Second Function.